I've been asking you to let me know which new C Sharp 11 features you'd be interested in me doing a video on, and I had a message from Syed Hasnajami asking about the new pattern matching features that we've got in C Sharp 11. Now, pattern matching has been around for quite a while in C Sharp, and I did a video a little while ago on relational patterns, but what we're going to look at is the new feature we have in C Sharp 11, which is what is known as list patterns. So if we just go over to Visual Studio, and the example I've got is one you'll quite often see when we're talking about list patterns. It's when we have something like a CSV file. So CSV is comma separated value, and it's a very simple way of having spreadsheet-like information in a file, because here we've got our file. And the way it works is that each new line represents a new row of data, and then within the row, we use comma separation, hence the name CSV, to indicate the different cells. And so what we've got in here is the title of a book is always the first item, so Pride and Prejudice, Persuasion, etc. Then we've got the author, so Jane Austen, and then later on Ian Fleming. Then we've got the year of publication. So we've got those in there. And then things get a little bit tricky, because then we have an arbitrary number of ratings for the book. So you can see that Pride and Prejudice has received 4 ratings, 3, 5, and a 4. We can see that Live and Let Die has 5 ratings, 5, 4, 3, 4, 5. And we can also see that Sense and Sensibility doesn't have any ratings at all. So that's a bit of a tricky thing to have, that variable length of how many ratings you've got, including possibly none. And then we've got on the end, the final piece of information is always the genre. So we've got classic and we've got thriller in this example. Now, that may not be a brilliant data layout. Having that variable number in the middle of it is going to be difficult to process. So if we were doing it from scratch, we might not design it this way. But this sort of data structure is something you may get from an external source and you've just got to live with it. So let's see how we can process that. So in our program, to start with, I've just opened up that books.csv and then I loop through. And what I do on each of those rows, so each read line will give me a new row, I split that on the comma, so our row will now be an array of individual cells. And then to start with, just so we can check it's working, I'm using string.join to stitch them all back together, but this time with a dash rather than a comma. So we'll see the same data, but dash separated rather than comma separated. So if we run that up, pretty straightforward. There we've got exactly that data, and we can see we've put in the dashes where we have the comma, so that's all working. But what we now want to do is actually start trying to match particular rows from that data. So we'll get rid of that console write line, and I'll show you the first example of this list pattern matching, which is to get you an exact match. Now, one thing we can't do is just do a double equals for comparison, because if we've got something like an array of strings, an array is a reference type, so the double equals will just give us whether or not they're the same object, not whether they are different objects that are identical. So that's not going to work. So what we have to do instead is say if, and then we say row is, and then to get an exact match, we just put in square brackets. So using the array syntax, we put what we're going to have in there. So if we get, say, let's go for that one, Sense and Sensibility by Jane Austen, written in 1811, and it's a classic. So if the row is that, then we'll output a message, Sense and Sensibility is exactly the book I want. And so what we'll see there when we run that is we get that message printed out exactly once. So we've looped through all 6 books, but that pattern is only matched once on the Sense and Sensibility row. Now that is giving us an exact match, but we can do rather more than that, because we can match just on a part of what's going on there. So what I'll actually do here, I'm going to change this to using a switch expression. So I'm going to say var reaction equals row switch, put in the curly braces. I'm going to give it a default, which is simply going to say nothing matched. And then I'm going to take the whole of that pattern and put it in as the first entry there, and that one is going to give us the message that we just wrote out there. So we can get rid of all of this and just at the end of it all do a console write line of the reaction. And so when we run that, we'll see that we get nothing matched for the 5 books that aren't Sense and Sensibility, but we then get that one in there. But let's suppose we want to do something more general than that. Let's suppose we want to get all of the books by a particular author, but there's nothing else that we're concerned with. So what we can do there is we can use the underscore as a discard that you may have seen in lots of situations that we have in C sharp. So I can say underscore to mean I don't care about the title. Then the next one I do care about, so this is going to match books by Ian Fleming. Then I don't care about the year, I don't care about the ratings, and I don't care about the genre. So I'm just looking for things by Ian Fleming. And the message I'll put out there is this book by Ian Fleming. And then I'm going to say something a little bit odd, has 5 items. And we'll see what I mean by that in a moment. But if we then run that, we can see that it's match Sense and Sensibility, and then this book by Ian Fleming has 5 items. And that's the last one in the list. And if we just take a quick look at the list, we can see that I'm correct about that. So Goldfinger, Ian Fleming, 1959, 5 Thriller. So a total of 5 items in that row. And that just shows us a slight problem, because if we use these discards, then what we get is exactly that number of items. So we've given it 1 fixed field and 4 discards, so it's only going to match if it's got 5 fields and the second one is Ian Fleming. So we can improve on things a bit with that, because we can do something like this. We can forget about those discards and instead use a dot dot to indicate a range. So what we're now saying is we don't care about the first field. The second field has to be Ian Fleming. But then after that, we can have as many other fields as we like and it will accept all of those. So it doesn't matter how many ratings it's got, anything by Ian Fleming will match them. Obviously, we can now change that message. So just go to this is a book by Ian Fleming and then run that. And we get 3 books by Ian Fleming. The last 3 are being matched on that basis. So that dot dot can be very useful because it allows us to not know exactly how many items there are in there. But even so, having done that, we don't actually know which book it is by Ian Fleming. So as well as matching with a pattern, what we often want to do is we want to extract data with a pattern. And we can do that by making a slight change. Rather than putting the underscore, I can say var and then title. So rather than saying it's got to have something at that first item, but we don't care what it is, now we're giving it a variable name. And so we can use that title now. In here, we'll just do some string interpolation and we can actually put in curly braces that title variable in there. And so now when we run that, we get Casino Royale is a book by Ian Fleming, Live and Let Die, Goldfinger. So it actually allows us to extract that information and make use of it. And that's done just by giving it a variable name. And you could have said string in there, but we've just used var because that's the more normal thing to do. We can, if we want to, take more than one variable out of there. So let's do a slightly different one. Let's do underscore. Then let's now select for Jane Austen. And then let's do var year. So remember that was the 3rd field. But then we've got the problem that we don't know how many ratings we're going to have. So now we put in dot dot. But then after the dot dot, we know that the very last thing, however many there are, is going to be the genre. So we can say var genre there. And then this one we can say gives. And then we could have a genre book was written in, and then year. And so if we run that, we can see it says a classic book was written in 1813, a classic book was written in 1818, and those are the first 2 we had there, 1813 and 1818. Notice Sense and Sensibility was matched to the earlier thing in the switch expression. So that's something to watch out for. If we hadn't have put that first one in there and we run that, now we can see it picks up all of them because it didn't get that direct match for Sense and Sensibility. So the thing to notice about that is that dot dot is representing 0 to many. So you don't have to have anything in there at all, because we know in the case of Sense and Sensibility, it goes straight from year to genre. So that dot dot is 0 or however many there may be until the last one is genre. Another thing to notice there is if we were to take that and put it in after the one that matches Jane Austen, then you can see we get an error. And it's quite easy to spot what the error is, but it's quite impressive that the compiler can spot it, I think, is that this one, remember, is going to catch every Jane Austen. So this pattern would already guarantee to have been caught by that pattern, and therefore there is no point in having it later on. We can have it earlier on because it will filter some of them out, but later on it can work out there's absolutely no possibility of it ever being hit. So it's quite helpful on that sort of thing as well, which is something that's always been there with pattern matching, and you may remember from when I was showing you the relational patterns. Now, another thing we might want to do is, if you look at what we've got here, we've managed to extract the title, the year, the genre, but what about those ratings? What if we want to get hold of what is in the dot dot? Well, we can do that as well, because what we can do is something like this. So let's go for var title, and then we'll just discard the author. Then we'll also discard the year. Then we're going to have our dot dot. But actually, we can still put in a variable there, just like we can with anything else. And if we take a look at that, if I just hover over that, you'll see that that ratings, because we used a var, has been implicitly typed to be an array of strings, which is what you expect when we're doing with a range. We still have to put that last one on the end, so that's going to pick up our genre, and then we can do something with that. So now we can say something like, we'll put in the title, and then we'll say has an average rating of, and then we'll do a little bit of maths there, so I'm going to say ratings dot select. So we're going to go through each rating, and the problem is that those ratings are strings, so we're going to have to convert them into integers. So we'll say r gives int dot parse r, so that will turn it into an integer, and then that select is going to give us back a collection out of ints. And so on the end of that, we can just do a dot average, and that will give us the average of all of those ratings. So far in that, we hit a slight problem that everything else has already been matched. So let's comment out that one and that one. Try it again. And now we can see we're getting those various average ratings for the different books. Now, that code wasn't particularly safe. It was just showing the idea. It's got a couple of problems. One is, obviously, if you try to parse the string and it's not an int, you're going to get an exception. The other one is, it does assume that ratings is going to contain something. So if we remove that one on sense and sensibility, remember sense and sensibility didn't have any ratings, what's now going to happen is we get this error on the average because you can't average a collection of zero elements. So we'd need to put a bit of safety code in there, but that's not really what we're talking about. We're talking about the pattern matching and the nice fact that the pattern matching allows us to extract not only individual values, but a range of values that it puts into an array for us. We might want to do that slightly differently, in fact. So if we get rid of that, we could just put in another one here and simply go 1, 2, 3, 4 for the title, author, year, and genre. So that would match anything that has no ratings, and we can just return has no ratings. And so that would just be another way of avoiding that particular problem. Now, something else we can do with this pattern matching is combine it with what we saw earlier, which is to do relational patterns. But unfortunately, that's not going to work in this particular example because relational patterns aren't allowed with strings. They're only allowed with numbers. So we'll have to have a slightly different example. So let's just comment that lot out for now. And then all I'll do is let's have a list of doubles. So there's our numbers. And we'll call that data. And we'll have that equals new list of doubles. And then we'll initialize that. So the first one we'll have is a new list of doubles. And we'll give that 1.5, 2.3, and 4.5. And then we'll just have a couple of more. Give those slightly different numbers. So let's make that one 1.3, make that one 1.5, and make that last one 0.5, doesn't matter too much. One thing to notice here, though, is that this is going to work on a list. So our previous example, we had an array, but this pattern matching works on basically just arrays and on lists. In fact, it'll work on anything that implements the iList interface or the iReadOnly list interface, which both arrays and lists do. So somewhat limited, but it's still pretty good in those cases. And then what we'll do, just for each var row in data, and then just to be a bit different, we won't use a switch expression, we'll use a switch statement because it's applicable to both. And then the sort of thing I can do now is I could say case, and then let's have a pattern of greater than one, comma, greater than one, comma, greater than one. And then if that happens, we'll write out a message that just sums that up. So we'll just take that and put it in there and have a break. And then the second one we'll do, we can have greater than one, greater than one, greater than four. Again, we'll notice we've got that problem that anything that could be matched by this one must already have been matched by that one. So we'll actually need to swap the order around there. And then the last one that we'll have, let's go for don't care how long it is. The only thing we care about is that the last one is actually less than one. And we'll pop that one in there. So same sort of features apply. We can still do the extraction and that sort of thing, but we can just do these matches on greater than, less than, all the things that we saw in that earlier video on relational patterns. But now if we run that one up, then we can see that it matches each one of those. So the first one matches on that last thing being greater than four. The second one matches on it being greater than one. And the third one matches on it being less than one. So just another example of how you can combine both the list pattern matching, which is new in C# 11, and the relational pattern matching that's been around for quite a few versions of C#. So I hope you enjoyed that. Do let me know if there's any other features of C# 11 you'd like me to go over. But if you did like that, do click like, do subscribe. I'll see you next time.